Well, dozens of hours later, here I am again. By now I have lots of gold and amulets and all the artifacts. I have 35 as my starting life total. That is, I explored the entire map and set up all of the mana links. I also defeated all of the evil wizards in the black, blue, red and green castle. Only the white one remains. And this is the deck that I have used to go through these previous four castles. It is just a mono red deck, whose main goal is to use acceleration like Sol Ring mainly, to ramp into a turn to big threats like Juggernaut, or Rock of Care Ridges, or maybe a Shivan Dragon on turn 3, or turn 4, that's also a fine plan. Now you might wonder why did I go with like this style of mono red deck rather than just using all of the best card draw in the game like Ancestral Recall and stuff like Contract from Below, which is definitely one of the best card draw spells ever printed. I mean, draw 7 cards for 1 black mana, that's just completely ridiculous. I just wanted to find a deck that could beat my opponents quickly, reliably and consistently. I mean, these decks that just draw a ton of cards with Ancestral Recall and then Contract from Below and then, I don't know, set up like a Time Walk and then Time Twister everything back. That is certainly a possibility, but I find it, well, it gets a bit boring after a couple of games. So I just decided to stick with this. You might also wonder, like, why did I choose some of these numbers, like lots of, like some 4, some 2, some 3s. How did I arrive at these numbers? That's just based on my, I guess, axiomatic approach to deck building. That is, I set a number of, well, numbers of things that I want. For example, I said, well, I want 21 mana sources, right? With the old Mulligan rules, that seems like a good number. Of those, I want 13 lands, because, well, I definitely want to hit my first and second land drops. And I also want at least 11 red sources. So then you get some constraints and do some optimization, and this is what you get. I mean, I need some mountains to be able to cast my spells, I also have Mox Ruby and Black Lotus for red mana. I have 13 lands, some colorless ones, because that was still allowed. Library of Alexandria is actually better than Mishra's Factory, but I didn't do enough grinding to get up to 4 libraries. We have to get these cards in the dungeons and then play against enemies that give you an additional card from your deck if you beat them. I didn't put in enough time to collect everything or like 4 Black Lotus or something. But yeah, so worth noting that I actually have some Moxen in my sideboard. I don't want those because, like, I would have to cut either a land, which I don't want, or a red mana source, which I don't want, or a Sol Ring, which I don't want. So that's the mana. As for the non-mana cards, the reason how I arrived at all of these numbers is kind of in the same way. I said, well, for the mana curve, I want 7 4 drops, that's a good number. Then I can reliably cast a big card on turn 2. And I want some late game, but not too much, because that leads to clunky draw. So I want 3 Shivan Dragon. And then I have like 9 slots for utility cards. Said, well, I want to have at least 6 cards that can do something useful on turns 1 or 2, especially if I don't draw any acceleration. I felt Lightning Bolt was the best, so then I filled up the rest with Curdapes, which works with Taiga, and then the remaining cards were filled in with Fireballs. So that's the general idea behind this deck. And now, let's just go to the final castle and kick out this white wizard. Kaboom. Ah, yeah, by now I've defeated a bunch of enemies many times. So they actually run away from me, and if I catch him, rather than like asking to battle, he will actually ask for mercy. Well, I'll accept tribute for my mercy. 40 food, it's fine. The wizards always sent out. Okay, well, this guy I haven't beaten enough. Well, I'm not gonna bother here. Especially when I have Sol Ring as my anti. That's another card I want to lose. I think the wizards sometimes send out emissaries, try to take over towns. But I'm gonna end the reign of the white wizard here. And I'm certainly brave enough. So here, in these castles, battling is quite difficult because opponents start with like a card that I think depends on the difficulty level, but here it is castle for the white castle. And they also generally start with a free creature in play at the beginning of the game. So you have to explore this. These castles are always randomly generated. And find the evil wizard. And often, to get there, you will have to go through some other enemies. There are also dice. If you run into a dice, you either get some free life at the beginning of the next duel, or you get a random artifact or creature from your deck in play at the start of the next duel. We are pretty lucky here. We get a Shivan Dragon. It's definitely the best one. And this is actually also related to a strategy that I will be using in the speed run. But, well, let me show you what will happen. Right, to advance, I have to run into this elephant here. And this is not going to be a fair game, because he starts with a castle, I start with a Shivan Dragon, and just to make it even more fair, this thing has basically haste as well. I can immediately attack with it. So it's completely ridiculous. A kaboom. You're at 9. Go. Your first turn, please. Yeah, this castle is not going to save him. Not in this game. God, bending. Most confusing ability ever. Well, fine. Just bump the dragon, and then we win on the next turn. Yeah, bending, I think it... well, no one ever understands how it works. But the idea, I think, is that you can block or attack as a band, and then you can distribute the damage over your creatures rather than the attacker. And it does some other strange things as well. But yeah, we beat that opponent. Not too difficult when you start the game with a Shivan Dragon in play. Lots of enemies here. Let's run into this question mark. Then you have to solve... solve a question, the total casting cost of Venom. I think that's 3, I believe. Yes, correcto. If I had given the wrong answer, then an enemy would have appeared here, but I was correct. Now the big wizards, they typically show up either on the top left or the top right corner. So I'm guessing that if I go into this direction, then I may encounter him. Okay, so now opponents also start with a 1-1 banding. It's fine. We have the double Library of Alexandria draw, so we're just gonna out card advantage this dude. Especially when we start at 35 life, we will have more than enough time to win that way. Draw cards. Yeah. Another card. Why not? I could lightning bolt something. But I think I'd rather just play Sol Ring here. Yep. Take some more damage. And cards like these, Library of Alexandria, are just completely overpowered. Same for Sol Ring. If I ever play a cube draft and have a choice between those two cards, well, it's pretty close actually. It's a tough call. Cards. Let's see, we can cast a guy here. Yeah, that's fine. This will block all of his creatures. Although I guess he can band. I still don't understand how this works. Okay, at least he doesn't attack, so I don't have to figure it out. Draw some more cards. Dun-dun. Another Walk of Carriages. Draw another card. Yeah, this'll work. This'll do. Eventually we will just draw into a fireball, and with all the Moxen and Black Lotus that we have, it will win the game pretty much immediately. Shivan Dragon, also acceptable. Oh. Ah, right. Yeah, the auto-tapping algorithm of Shandalar is not the best, or I guess it's also pretty difficult for a computer to figure out how I would want to tap this exactly. I wanted to leave the Library of Alexandria open, but I guess... Oh, and I clicked through my attack step accidentally as well. Yeah, not really the best play I'm showcasing here, but it doesn't really matter. We are easily winning this game. We have a two-turn clock, and we're still drawing three cards a turn, while our opponent has a bunch of dudes. Yeah, I'm not gonna... Oh, I should have drawn cards first, of course. I'm not gonna let him get some banding tricks. Whenever there's a creature with flying and banding, I just kill it immediately. I don't want to think about how that even works. Way too complicated. And whatever. Might as well keep some cards in hand to play around Wrath of God or something. This doesn't really seem like a Wrath of God deck with this many 1 and 2 drops, but you never know. And kaboom. That should be the game. Okay. Yeah, in this direction then. Now our opponent starts with a War Elephant. 2-2 Banding Trample for 4 mana. That's indeed how creatures looked like back in the days. Mana Vault. Yeah, that gives a bunch of mana, but also some additional damage every turn. I don't think the computer is smart enough to untap it. I guess I could have added some more soul things here, whatever. I'm just gonna... Well, was planning to beat him down with Walk of Carriages. Double Bolt. It's an option. Yeah, let's just do that. It's fine. This way we can keep on attacking. We're not taking any damage from the Seraph Angel either. Oh yeah, our opponent will now take damage from the Mana Vault. So far, so good. Onulet? Yeah. This is a little late to the party. Fine. Two more turns. And we should be there. Juggernaut. Not really the best when he has this board, though at least it will keep my opponent from actually attacking. That's fine. And often opponents randomly attack into my Juggernaut anyway, as happens right now. As I said, the AI has some issues, because this deck obviously doesn't make any sense at all. Let's block the banding guy. But I'll take it. Okay. And still haven't found the big boss. This is quite a strange layout, actually. I mean, where would he be? As I said, typically it's in the top left or top right corner. But it doesn't look like that's the way it is. Well, maybe he's in the very left, so I have to go this way. Life in the Next Duel, fine. Lord of Atlantis, well, that's a card I know from Modern. So no enemy will appear here. One starts with a Benelish Hero. Acceptable. I'll start with 3 Solvings on turn 1, go. Oh! Don't forget to play the Juggernaut as well. Almost clicked through my turn, and of course opponents always attack into the Juggernaut. I don't know why, but again, I'll take it. If I draw a Fireball, it's also going to be sweet with all these Solvings here. Sure, Assembly Worker. Meantime, my opponent's not really doing anything at all, so should have him dead on the next turn. Yeah, I'll hold you. Okay, fine, fine. You got me. So then, well, he's not dead here, but he'll be dead on the next turn, hopefully. Dingus Egg. This card doesn't do anything at all. So, congratulations. With your egg. And take a bolt. Next guy. Starts with Mesa Pegasus, which is fairly annoying, since I still don't understand banding. I guess we're gonna go turn one Rock of Carriages. It's not the worst, I guess. Solving as well. Yeah, sure. I mean, this is not really what you typically use a Black Lotus for. Not in Vintage. Oh yeah, we had one mana too much, so then for every mana unspent you lose a life. Yeah, this game uses the old rules when there was still mana burn. So if my understanding of banding is correct, my opponent can band these two into a single band, even though Savannah Lines doesn't have flying. It can share the flying from Mesa Pegasus. And then my opponent can distribute the 3 damage from Rock of Carriages over his creatures so that none of them actually die. So that means I actually cannot attack here, which is fairly annoying. This is castle and a flying banding creature is actually pretty good against my deck. So library, nah, my opponent is mana screwed. Just go with the Sheevan. A better plan. But this guy can attack. No matter how you band, and I think you can only put one non-banding creature into a band. Boom. Yeah, so indeed, not able to block the Sheevan Dragon. I mean, you can ban Mesa Pegasus with Savannah Lions, double block, but that doesn't get you anywhere. You cannot ban Mesa Pegasus with 2 or more creatures, but now... Frankly, I have no idea how this is gonna work exactly. Maybe you can like block with 2 Mesa Pegasus and then 2 Savannah Lions. Or maybe it's still one non-banding creature per band. But maybe it's one non-banding creature per creature with banding in a band. For science, I'm just gonna attack here and see what happens. Okay, so it looks like my opponent indeed cannot quadruple block this thing. It's good for me. Maybe if he had done that, then I still would have had the lightning bolt. Oh god. I guess we'll see what happens here. Acceptable. Okay, I was expecting the AI to teach me a lesson in banding and then like triple blocking with three different bands or something. Come on, what's up with this? But I guess if he starts jumping with Maze of Pegasus, I will eventually win this game. The sound effects are always beautiful when you play planes. Ooh, more bat mana, always good. What the hell? Fast, my bolt. Yes, bolt and response. Quick. +7/+7. Right. Well, close call. I guess next turn I can attack with both. That is fine. Yep. He has to jump block the Shivan Dragon. And next turn I should win. Yeah, so it takes a while. Armageddon. Well, how's that gonna save you out of this situation? Well, Bolt you. Okay. Nice try, though. Ah, the evil wizard is indeed here in this corner. So, we start with solving. But this might be negated. If this dice gives us life, then we also lose the solving. Let's see what we get. Only life. So, you know what? I'm gonna walk back to get this dice. Because maybe we get a Shivan Dragon after this one. Nope, just life. Well then. We'll play without a free card. We should also be able to beat this guy while playing fair. Well, he's not playing fair. He starts with a castle and a war elephant. And 30 life. Well, let's play first. Let's start. Hey, we have a Library of Alexandria. So we'll just go for the card advantage game then. As always, hard to lose when you're drawing two cards a turn. Yeah, Curd Ape, it's fine. And I could ramp into Juggernaut, but actually when he has Circle of Protection Artifacts, I was gonna say like Castle and Creatures, but Circle of Protection Artifacts is another good thing against Juggernaut. Yeah, we could still play the Sol Ring. That way, if we draw into, I guess, a Shivan Dragon on the next turn, we might be able to play it. Hawk of Care Riches, also acceptable. Yeah, we can add a Sol Ring in here as well. Then we take a mana burn, but that's okay. At least we develop our board in a good way. Blessing. Sure. I mean, this card is like creature enchantments are already bad because of like the card advantage or card disadvantage rather. This thing just takes so much mana. This would easily be a 14th pick if we were playing more contemporary limited format. But I'll just add another flyer and fly over this big elephant. Well, that's somewhat annoying. I guess we can bolt in response, but it doesn't accomplish anything. No, we will just lose our lands, but he also loses his lands, while I am completely far ahead on the board, and well, I still have plenty of things to play here. Yeah, this could definitely be worse. Even the Juggernaut is active now that he doesn't have lands for his Circle of Protection anymore. So, this doesn't seem to be the best time to play Armageddon, but I'll take it. Opponent doesn't have any lands. Right. Well, then I'm probably winning. I can attack with the Gurdip as well. If he blocks, then I'll just bolt his dude. Maybe actually at lethal here if I start burning him. Whatever, we can. Maybe I still have lethal. 7, 10 mana. Oh, yes, it is. Super bad manners. But I guess the AI doesn't care. Yay, we did it! I've defeated the dreaded white wizards. No longer shall his evil creatures oppress the good people of Shandalar. Yay! Hate those white mages too. Because now I can take 3 different white cards. I don't really care. I mean, if this were like earlier in the game, I would probably take something like a farmstead. This card looks absolutely terrible and completely unplayable, and it is, but for some reason it sells for a lot of gold in the game. And I might also take a jewel land, because those are always useful. Savannah or something, and whatever, just a random card. Don't care. So, I've defeated all 5 wizards. Shandalar, that's the plane that this game is set on, is free. Prepare to face the final challenge. And that is against the evil planeswalker Arzakon. Right, I'm not sure who came up with this, but Arzakon it is. And each life it loses in the final battle will banish it for 10 additional years. So that's what I will be facing in the next video. See you there.